In this, the last of the histology lectures, I'll cover a few other random tissues found above the neck. First, let's cover the salivary glands. This should be review, but a gland is made of epithelial cells. There are endocrine glands, which do not contain ducts, and these dump hormones into the bloodstream. That makes them special because these epithelial tissues are vascular, unlike all the rest. But up in the head, we're going to be focused on exocrine glands, which produce some sort of secretion that leaves the body through a duct to either the outer or the inner surface. If you need to take a moment to review the functions and compositions of saliva, please do so now. The one component I would like to highlight is that saliva is a mixture of water, glycoproteins, and minerals. These glycoproteins are mucousy proteins. So just think about boogers for a minute. I know, it's amazing to think about such things in a college course, but a booger is really just dehydrated mucus. Add a bunch of water to that, and now you've got a sticky solution known as saliva, which can coat the entire mouth rather than dripping to the very bottom, which is what it would do if it was mostly water. So these mucousy glycoproteins are very important to its function, and that actually relates to the histology of these glands. The other part that we'll want to talk about that has some clinical significance is the fact that there are electrolytes and minerals found within saliva. This can be very important to the remineralization of enamel, as well as to some disease states. One of the main functions of saliva is to act as a buffer so that our teeth don't erode when we eat acidic foods. It's also antibacterial, helping to wash bacteria off of our teeth down into the stomach for destruction. If you've taken the oral microbiology class, you know that the mouth is full of bacteria, but there would be even more if it wasn't for saliva. Now, the minerals found within saliva can stay in the saliva, giving it kind of a salty flavor, or they can precipitate out of solution onto the surface of the teeth, creating calculus. This can be a problem because it makes the surface of the enamel bumpier, which allows bacteria to adhere to the surface more easily and resist being washed down in the stomach by saliva. This is, of course, one place where the dental hygienist comes into play, ensuring that the surface of an enamel is smooth. There are major and minor salivary glands, with the main difference being mostly size, but predominantly the major ones have been given names. They are all exocrine glands, meaning they all have ducts, and they all share similar histology. Your basic salivary gland consists primarily of simple cuboidal epithelial cells that produce saliva. These are arranged into structures called acini, which often surround the beginning of a duct. The ducts are also composed of epithelial cells arranged into tubes, and these allow for saliva to exit the gland. Epithelial cells are pretty squishy, so to give these glands some structure, they are surrounded by connective tissue, like some dense, irregular connective tissue that's mostly collagen fibers. This connective tissue may extend into the gland, dividing it into separate chambers or rooms. The little walls that separate the rooms are called septa and are made of the same connective tissue as the outer capsule. And this is the basic histology of a salivary gland. Now, the acini come in different shapes, and you could memorize those shapes and be able to identify them under the microscope, but in this course, because our school does not have microscopes in the dental hygiene department, that's not going to be my focus. My main focus is on the different types of saliva that are produced. Saliva can be a mixture of serous secretions, which are more watery, and more mucousy secretions, which are stickier. Serous acini tend to be rounder and more grape-shaped, whereas mucous acini tend to be more elongated. But they serve the same basic function. These epithelial cells produce the secretions known as saliva, and the main difference being in the amount of glycoproteins that those cells produce and secrete. Here's some actual histology. In the larger glands, you may find both serous and mucous acini in the same area, and therefore the saliva that that gland produces is a mixture of watery and mucousy secretions. Nevertheless, those secretions, which are made by these acini, are then secreted into a duct, which exits onto the surface of the oral mucosa. A third type of acinus is a mucoserous acinus, and I hope you can guess what it makes. It secretes some serousy secretions and some mucousy secretions. It's a mixture of the two types. And if in this picture the serous acini stain pretty darkly and the more mucousy ones appear a little bit lighter, the mucoserous ones look like a lighter region with a little hat or a bonnet of the darker staining cells. Now, if you're curious, the stain that makes these cells dark is staining for proteins. And if you've got a bunch of fluffy mucousy stuff inside of you, you don't stain quite as darkly. There's our mucoserous acini right there, which is half the lighter pink and half the darker pinkish purplish color. Let's zoom in a little bit closer to compare once again what mucous acini look like under the microscope, as can be seen over here to the left, versus what the serous acini look like. And that's what we can see in the picture over here to the right. So now that I've updated my cartoon to show serous, mucous, and mucoserous acini, we have to add one more cell type, which are myoepithelial cells. So two little parts about that word myoepithelial. The first that you should focus on is that these are indeed epithelial cells, even though they're going to look a little bit more and function more like muscle cells. We say that they're epithelial cells because of their lineage. They divided from stem cells that turned into other epithelial cells, so they belong in the family of epithelium. However, these cells are kind of special. Whereas most other epithelial cells, as they differentiate from a stem cell, they will methylate all of the genes necessary for making thick and thin filaments the way that a muscle cell would, and then wrapping those unneeded genes around histones and putting them into deep storage. They only need the DNA for doing epithelial things unpacked, so they pack away all of the stuff that they're not going to need. These myoepithelial cells, on the other hand, undo that step and instead start transcribing genes as if they were more like a muscle cell. But just because they're specialized and different from the rest of their family members doesn't throw them into a different family. So these myoepithelial cells are capable of contraction, the way that smooth or striated muscle does, and that helps to squeeze the fluids out of the rest of those epithelial cells in the acini and force it into a duct and then out into the oral cavity. There are different types of ducts, which get different names based off of the shape of the cells that surround that duct. They might be cuboidal, they might be more columnar, and honestly, I would take a look at this information and do a little bit of triage here. This seems like something highly unlikely to be on a license exam, primarily because there's no pathology that goes along with these names. So if you get bored, I would come back to this slide and memorize those names. But I am going to be moving forward. There are three major salivary glands, which are big enough to get names. We might even be able to throw a set of fourth in here. And then there's going to be a bunch of small ones. These different glands produce different amounts of mucousy proteins, but keep in mind, all of this stuff is going to be mixing together in the oral cavity to make saliva. Let's start with the parotid salivary glands. I have a little cartoon up here which illustrates the basic anatomy of how the duct leaves the parotid gland, goes around the masseter muscle, pierces through the buccinator muscle, and exits into the oral cavity. Down below, we can see the parotid papillae, the little bumps where the ducts exit, just to the sides of the second maxillary molars. Mumps is a disease where the parotid salivary glands become infected and inflamed. Now, some of our older textbooks will say that it is rarely seen in the developed world, but thanks to the morons who think that MMR causes all sorts of problems, we're now seeing a significant uptick in the outbreak of mumps and other preventable diseases. This is not a patient that you would want coming into the clinic. Next up are the submandibular and sublingual salivary glands. These glands share an exit called the sublingual caruncle. They're below the tongue. There are also a number of minor salivary glands scattered throughout the oral cavity. I'm showing you this picture of nicotinic stomatitis once again, because that condition allows us to actually see these minor salivary glands. Once you give them a more whitish keratinized background to be distinguished from. These small salivary glands contain acini, mostly mucousy ones, and a duct, tiny one, that doesn't get any sort of name, that exits into the oral cavity. There are some salivary glands associated with the circumvolate papillae of the tongue. These are pretty small, but they were big enough to get this person's name, the von Ebner glands. If the salivary glands are not functioning properly, that can lead to a reduction in saliva production, known as xerostomia. That can cause all sorts of conditions because, as you've hopefully learned in another class, saliva has a number of very important functions within the oral cavity. There's a lot of reasons why somebody could be suffering from xerostomia. That includes a number of medications that they could potentially be on, or a few diseases that they may have, or maybe cancer chemotherapy. Lastly, nerve damage can also cause xerostomia, because remember, the salivary glands are under the control of both the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous systems. Both of those would trigger saliva production. Therefore, damage to either one of those types of nerve fibers could reduce the amount of saliva that's produced. If you need a refresher on some of the symptoms of xerostomia, please read this list. But we're going to skip forward and next talk about what can happen to the salivary glands that our knowledge of histology might help illuminate. The first is blockage of the salivary glands. A sialolith is a small rock made from saliva, or more accurately, from the mineral components found within saliva. If there's a reduction in the amount of water, then some of those minerals might bump into each other and precipitate or drop out of solution. And once they do, they can form a nucleus, not like the nucleus found in the center of a cell or the nucleus found in the center of an atom. This nucleus is going to be found at the center of a large rock. It was the beginning of that rock. A few atoms that have precipitated together can help others leave solution and become a part of that tiny little rock. And over time, it might become big enough to actually block off one of the ducts of a salivary gland. And when that happens, that salivary gland is going to keep producing saliva, because it does so under the control of the sympathetic or parasympathetic nervous system. There's no measurement going on for where the saliva is going. And if saliva backs up in that duct and it can't exit, that can lead to the production of a mucocele or a ranula, depending on whether this is a minor or a major salivary gland that's been blocked. I'll show you pictures of those next, but really quickly here, we just want to highlight this little stone, the sialolith, that of course came from this little hole here where it needed to be surgically removed from. Here are some sialoliths still in situ, and we see that saliva is backing up and causing the skin, or I should say, oral mucosa underneath to bulge. Again, the distinction between these two is mainly in size. A mucocele is the blockage of a minor salivary gland, whereas a ranula is a larger blockage in one of the major salivary glands. To try and identify exactly where the blockage is, so that a small incision can be made to remove it without doing a bunch of exploratory surgery, one technique is to simply take an x-ray of the patient. And this can work because stones show up on x-ray. Those sialoliths are denser than the soft tissues found within a salivary gland, which is mostly epithelial cells and a little bit of connective tissue. Those things don't show up on radiographs without some specialized settings. One sort of specialized setting is the use of a contrast agent. In this case, sialography injects a dense liquid up a salivary duct, pushing it backwards in the opposite direction of where saliva would normally travel, forcing it all the way back up until it runs into a blockage. And here in this image, we can see that that contrast agent is able to get all the way back up into one part of this parotid salivary gland up here. That connection is just fine, but down here, we're not getting as much contrast agent. So there must be a blockage somewhere preventing materials from exiting here. Next, I'm going to cover the lymphatic system. Actually, I'm not going to cover all of it, thank goodness, just the parts that can be found in or near the oral cavity. And that's two major structures. The first are the tonsils, found back in the pharynx, and the second are some lymph nodes, which are significant because they are connected to the teeth. First off, though, lymphatic vessels are small tubes similar to veins, but these carry a different type of fluid. There's no red blood cells in there. So if arteries can bring blood to a tooth, and some of that fluid gets squeezed out of tiny capillary beds to become extracellular fluid, which would now be found in the ground substance within the pulp cavity, that fluid needs to be reabsorbed. the cells in here will use up all of the nutrients and deposit all of their wastes. Some of that fluid can be returned via veins, but the rest of it has to be picked up by the lymphatic system. So exiting each tooth are a series of small, squishy tubes known as lymphatic vessels. And these pick up the extra fluid, drain it away from the teeth, until it re-enters the circulatory system. While it's in a lymphatic vessel, we call it lymph. But when it returns to the blood supply, we once again call that fluid plasma. Before it reaches the blood, we have to clean that fluid up a bit. Remember, we've deposited a bunch of waste materials into this fluid, and we may even have a bunch of garbage from dying cells or even bacteria or viruses. So the lymphatic vessels will carry this fluid through a series of structures called lymph nodes. These are tiny bean-shaped structures found throughout the entire body. There's a high number of them in certain regions. For us, we're going to care that there's a large number in the cervical area. These lymph nodes function in two major fashions. One, they contain a high number of white blood cells, which can help to remove a bunch of large debris from this fluid before it becomes plasma once again. That debris may be dead cells or bits of dead cells. But another thing that white blood cells can do is identify pathogens. So if there's any sort of infection going on in the teeth, it may be identified in nearby lymph nodes. This will then trigger an inflammatory response, and those lymph nodes will become inflamed, which means they will become swollen. And based on the pattern of swelling, we can potentially track down the source of that infection to specific regions of teeth. When they are not inflamed, lymph nodes don't feel like anything because they're mostly just a bunch of white blood cells. And your basic cell is pretty squishy. If you press on it, it will deform and not feel like anything. Lymph nodes contain a number of afferent vessels. These are lymphatic vessels that lead towards the lymph node. And just a few efferent vessels. So there are fewer exits. And that will create a bunch of turbulence inside of the lymph node, giving the white blood cells more time to identify waste, debris, and pathogens. The basic histology of a lymph node should sound very similar. We've got an outer layer of connective tissue, probably dense, irregular connective tissue. It's mostly collagen, nonetheless, whatever we call it. That connective tissue can extend inwards, separating a lymph node into separate chambers. The walls of this connective tissue would be called trabeculae. And unlike a salivary gland now, the interior of a lymph node is not epithelial. It's connective tissue. It's mostly white blood cells, lymphocytes, macrophages, neutrophils, etc. They can be clustered in specific regions that are visible under the microscope, known as a tiny nodule. The tonsils are very similar to lymph nodes under the microscope, with a few exceptions. One, they're much closer to the surface of the body. So a tonsil is going to be surrounded by a stratified squamous epithelium. Here's the epithelium here, but then underneath that, we have tissue that resembles that lymph node. It's mostly white blood cells that are organized in a way that we can identify, or clusters of white blood cells. Now, one major difference between a tonsil and a lymph node is that tonsils are not connected to lymphatic vessels. It is not their responsibility to filter anything. They are strictly for identification. For instance, if I were to see a chocolate donut on the floor, and as you do, I would definitely pick it up and eat it. But if that was coated with bacteria, some of those bacteria would wind up in a tonsil, and the white blood cells could then identify those pathogens quickly and alert the rest of the body to be on the lookout for those specific floor donut pathogens. Here's my cartoon of a tonsil, and basically we've got white blood cells arranged into clusters with this funky surrounding of a stratified squamous epithelium. That epithelium invaginates, or folds inwards, providing some surface area to this tonsil so that it can collect more debris and garbage and pathogens from floor donuts and whatnot. And we call those infoldings tonsillar crypts. If you were to look into somebody's mouth, there would be a ring of tonsils back in the pharynx. There's a lingual tonsil at the back of the tongue, a pair of palatine tonsils, a pair of tubal tonsils next to where the eustachian tubes open up, and lastly, a pharyngeal tonsil up in the nasopharynx. The exact location of these tonsils is not the focus of a histology class, but you might need to know this for your head and neck anatomy class. What's more significant to us is what happens to these tissues when they become inflamed, such as during an infection. And as you remember from a few chapters ago, the inflammatory process consists of redness, swelling, heat, and pain. And in this case, it's the swelling and possibly the pain that are the most significant. When lymph nodes in the cervical region become swollen, they now become palpable. Normally, you should not be able to feel these structures because they're so soft and squishy. But now that they've become swollen and filled with fluid, they're now have more shape and structure to them and can be felt. Again, this is a patient that you probably don't want to see. The tonsils can also become inflamed, but because they're closer to the surface, we can see something happening here that's also happening in a lymph node that's just not visible. And that is, during the inflammatory response, we've got white blood cells releasing inflammatory molecules, which cause white blood cells to undergo mitosis and make large numbers of copies of themselves to fight an infection. But these white blood cells don't live forever, and some of them, in order to kill a bacterium, actually have to kill themselves in the process. So we're making lots of white blood cells, but they're also now dying at a higher rate. That's totally normal for the immune system. But the little corpses that they leave behind cause this pussy secretion that we might be able to see when there's an inflammatory response happening in tonsillar tissue. One more thing about the lymph nodes is that they are connected in a specific fashion. For instance, the maxillary incisors drain into submental lymph nodes. That means if there's an infection in those teeth, you will see inflammation in the submental lymph nodes. From there, the fluid will next drain into submandibular lymph nodes, which could cause swelling down here. However, if you see swelling in just the submandibular but not the submental lymph nodes, that could indicate an infection in teeth other than those mandibular incisors. So, from the swelling of the lymph nodes in the neckish area, we can draw some conclusions about potential infections within the teeth. From these locations, the fluid would next drain into cervical lymph nodes, and then those too might become inflamed. Next up are the sinuses. And then we're almost done. The sinuses communicate with the nasal cavity, which is a fancy way of saying that these two spaces are connected to one another. But the connections are pretty tiny. Take a look at this x-ray here and see if you can spot the connection to where the maxillary sinuses connect to the nasal cavity. There they are, right about there. These connections are small enough that a little bit of inflammation can close them off. And that means that any fluid entering into the paranasal sinuses, like into these maxillary sinuses here, would have nowhere to exit. And that can lead to pain and discomfort known as a sinus infection. The sinuses are lined with a pseudostratified epithelium. This is different from the oral mucosa, which was a stratified squamous epithelium. As you get further back, we're now thinner, and it's pseudostratified. It still has multiple layers of cells, but not nearly as many. And what makes this a little bit different is we produce a lot more mucus. So embedded in this epithelium are other epithelial cells known as goblet cells, which produce mucus, which can trap garbage, which can then be removed from the body by the movement of the cilia. Below this epithelium is some areolar connective tissue and some dense irregular connective tissue. The exact same pattern that we saw in the skin and the oral mucosa. We had an epithelium, a little bit of areolar connective tissue, where there was a lot of blood supply, and then some dense irregular connective tissue. Mucus is an important secretion. It's made of glycoproteins, which have to be synthesized on the rough endoplasmic reticulum and go through the Golgi apparatus before being secreted. Inflammation of the sinuses can be visualized using radiography. And I challenge you to ask your instructor in that class, how exactly an x-ray can pick up excess mucus and fluid? I'm not really clear on the answer to that. I just think it's a pretty fascinating question. Nevertheless, in this image to the right, we can see one of the maxillary sinuses is inflamed. One of the reasons that we are concerned about this is that the posterior maxillary teeth can be really close to or even partially inside of the maxillary sinuses, which means that any sinus infection would have a route where it could spread to become an infection of those teeth. Lastly, when scouring test questions and study guides for questions on your license exam related to the histology of these tissues, I found very little. I did find a number of questions related to the anatomy of these structures that you should be covering in your head and neck anatomy course and in your anatomy prerequisites. Nevertheless, I did cover a little bit of anatomy today, so why don't we cover those questions? First off, these submental lymph nodes, where do they receive lymph from? And you should know that, yes, indeed, that is the mandibular incisors. And therefore, this next question, is it the mandibular molars that travel to those lymph nodes? No, it is not. And then over to this question here, the maxillary first premolar. Which of the following are true? Ooh, this is difficult, especially considering most of these answers have nothing to do with embryology or histology. Therefore, I haven't covered them. But the one thing that I did cover was this maxillary sinus. Can the roots penetrate the maxillary sinus? And I said that could happen from the posterior teeth, which can include this first premolar. Yes. So that is a possibility of an anatomical variation of those teeth. The rest of these possibilities, you're going to have to go to your other courses, determine whether these are true or false. But that's going to wrap up my lecture on the histology of the other structures found up in the head and neck.